Elizabeth.
Hello, Stephanie.
I'm so excited that we have this opportunity to speak about your work in this context, because we have been speaking about your work so intensively for the last year. Mm-hmm. And I've been working on an essay about your work for the last 6 months, which I'm going to finish soon. But it's been such a pleasure and such an honor to dive so deeply into your work.
It's been amazing to be in conversation with you, such depthful conversation over such a long period of time.
Yeah.
It's an opportunity that I've never had before, and mm-hmm. you know, because I'm in that conversation with my work, but
right.
you have really been occupying that space with me.
Well, you've allowed me to do that. And I think that, you know, we're having a lot of cultural conversations about writing and the value and the importance of writing. But we don't talk very much about what writing needs,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Mm-hmm.
We don't talk very much about what painting needs culturally too, right?
No.
What an artist needs.
Yeah, we pretend that
Well, thank God for the Ford Family Foundation. Yeah. But I think that writing, like, this is, you know, I feel like this is my most accomplished piece of writing.
Mm.
It will be. And it's partly because you've given me so much access, and we've talked about the writing, but because I've had the time.
Mm.
Like,
mm-hmm.
writing needs time.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like painting in that sense.
Mm-hmm.
It needs to be layered. It needs to be scraped away.
Mm-hmm.
It needs to be reworked.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah, and every time we talk, I learn something new that then forms a piece of the writing
mm-hmm.
as well. And
yeah.
I've been so, I'm going to keep using the word honored. I've been so honored that you've told me a number of times that as I've shared the writing with you, it's been something that you've taken in your mind into the studio.
Absolutely.
You know?
Yeah. It's our... the conversation that we've had is not a kind of conversation that I've really ever had before, at least in such an extended fashion,
mm-hmm.
you know? Like, I have had those profound conversations maybe in critiques or studio visits,
mm-hmm.
but they're these little moments
mm-hmm.
of that, and
mm-hmm.
ours has been so sustained,
yeah.
you know, and that's been incredible, and it's also been so easy.
Mm.
It just developed so naturally,
yeah.
and that I think it couldn't have happened if it didn't develop so naturally on both sides.
Yeah,
and to like the space of the studio, or I am sure the space of, you know, your writing
mm.
is such a solitary
mm-hmm.
space.
Right.
So profoundly
solitary. Oh, I'm so glad you brought
solitary.
That up. Yeah.
And so it's really been just unprecedented to be in that space with you. And
mm-hmm.
I think that it really has, it's influenced how the essay has affected me.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it has influenced how my studio practice has unfolded, you know, sort of since.
Mm-hmm.
It's been, I think actually it's been a really healing
wow, that's amazing.
Thing.
I think I would say the same. It's also, spending such time with you and your work has also challenged me to see painting in new ways,
mm.
to see feminism and the feminist power in new ways.
Hmm.
I mean, one thing that we talked about is that you've chosen not to depict scenes of violence against women,
mm-hmm.
so that you're not allowing, if you will, the person who's viewing your painting to become the voyeur
mm-hmm.
of that violence.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And in these paintings in particular, the actors are very solitary,
mm-hmm.
and there's this kind of deep, which I've been calling in my essay a kind of subterranean, even though, as we know, the depth of the painting is about less than a quarter of an inch.
Uh-huh. At the most,
which mm-hmm. is another remarkable thing about painting.
Mm-hmm.
And it's more than their stillness that's happening in the work. It's much more. But for the sake of our interview and our job that we're going to do right now,
mm-hmm.
I mean, this is one body of work, right? And it was completed together.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Right? It's mm-hmm. it's not an assembly of things that you had going on from
right.
2 years ago or
right.
Right. This is the vision that you've created during a very difficult time.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe we could start with you talking about that year and how the paintings evolved.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you,
yeah,
by the way.
Absolutely. So you're absolutely right. The work is a body of work that was conceived of together. And that's how I work. That's how mm-hmm. I have been working for a number of years. Mm-hmm. I think of the paintings as a kind of family, mm-hmm. like a sibling, the dynamics that can happen in a family, the love and the antagonism mm-hmm. and the trauma and the history. And mm-hmm. so there's that all happens as the work is being made, is the pieces influence each other.
Do they have like that kind of influence? Do you see it as art historical as well as emotional or like
absolutely yeah sort of all of the things mm-hmm. you know references get sort of echoed mm-hmm. and bounced around, and then affects or tones or mm-hmm. memories also get bounced around mm-hmm. you know, it becomes a kind of echo chamber. Like it's very hard for me to make a one-off painting
mm-hmm.
it feels like a vacuum, like mm-hmm. I'm trying to create something in a vacuum. I feel like I need the community to arise, the community of paintings to arise so mm-hmm. that they can talk to each other.
Mm-hmm.
Also, it's very rare for me to work on one painting at a time. Mm-hmm. I like to work on at least two paintings at a time. Mm-hmm. And so that's also part of the co-evolution of the paintings.
Do you participate in that conversation that they're having, if you will? Or is it something that you witness? Like, do you feel like you have a position, a kind of subject position in relationship to that family that you're creating?
It's kind of like a gestalt situation where mm-hmm. I am occupying different mm-hmm. subject positions.
So it's all you. That's an overgeneralization, I know.
Yeah.
But I just want to understand maybe a little bit more.
I try not to over-define it. I would say in general, I feel more like a child in relation to the paintings, mm-hmm. but I know that is also just part of like, you know, my personality, and I know that I occupy like a parental or an authoritative position at times. You know, it's just something that I'm less like aligned with in my personality, but mm-hmm. but I think it would be dishonest to say that I am not in control, at least
right.
in some ways, you know,
right.
like I do not try to overanalyze it. And that's been such a wonderful thing about our conversation, is that it somehow was able to stay in that very intuitive
mm-hmm.
space,
mm-hmm.
which is very hard to maintain. It's so, I feel like we're trained to want to sort of step out of that space.
Absolutely.
And analyze it and name it. Like Amy Silman and Greg Bordowitz talk about that. Like
right.
she's like, why can't we just be in the feeling
right.
more, you know?
Absolutely. And moments like this are often tend to, I think, out of some sense of obligation, dwell in that other space where
yes.
we're trying to explain, right?
Like, and I'm okay. Like, I invite that space once the work is out of the studio.
Okay.
Like, I love to actually go into that space
mm-hmm.
and psychoanalyze the paintings and sort of analyze them.
Mm-hmm.
I find that fascinating and
mm-hmm.
very enriching.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that I try not to mix those two things when I'm actually making the paintings
mm-hmm.
because that the relationship to the painting is like a gossamer, you know, it's these gossamer threads
mm-hmm.
and the intellect can just come in like a bull in a china shop
mm-hmm.
and just sort of wreak havoc with that. So
mm-hmm.
I do try to keep it in this sort of peripheral space
mm-hmm.
and let it happen. And you did, you've
yeah.
asked me so many great things that I want to respond to. And maybe you're asking about something else, but you're asking like, how present are you in the creation of, in the sort of evolution of the works? Or is it sort of in this kind of memory space?
Mm-hmm.
And I would say both mm-hmm. together,
mm-hmm.
you know, the art historical references are happening and sort of growing.
Mm-hmm.
And then a lot of things that happen in my day-to-day life, mm-hmm. I bring into the studio every day. So mm-hmm. it's not just this like sort of metaphorical, right. imaginative space. It's also right. this very real space. Mm-hmm. And those things are commingling in the studio mm-hmm. In their own, under their own auspices, sort mm-hmm. of.
Yeah, I feel like you show us that very clearly. And sometimes it's very shocking. You introduce contemporary technology, for instance, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. And it's going to be really interesting 20 years from now when the laptop is this kind of antique relic. Mm-hmm. Eve Ellen Blatt talks about that in Painting as Model, mm-hmm. how modernism is already an antiquity.
Right.
And I feel that in this work behind us, in Revelations, right, where you have this sort of reference to modernism, which mm-hmm. is this tiled floor, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it's so interesting that it's the floor. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about that floor? Like, mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely. It's interesting because that is actually an example of something that I saw, in my morning coming to the studio that came directly into the painting. I mean, modernism is a big theme I return to mm-hmm. in my
Western
works.
Western modernism.
Yes, modernist painting as this point where, you know, the figure is really finally excised from the painting,
right.
you know, and just that triumphal moment is something that I return to over and over again mm-hmm. as in conversation
Are you talking about somebody else's triumph?
Yes. Yeah. Yes, which I see as a, you know, a false
right.
triumph.
And a misogynistic one.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And, you know, Eurocentric and all of the things yeah. that come with that. Yeah, because the figure can never be excised from the painting
right.
because the figure is making the painting. The
right.
the psychology is within the you know, the aspects of the painting, whatever those aspects are.
Mm-hmm.
So that... Yeah, it just is such a naive and also brutal exclamation. And mm-hmm. so it's something that I return to over and over. And Mondrian, I had been sort of in my mind for a while.
Mm-hmm.
I was reading Ninth Street Women, talking about the female abstract expressionist painters and different modernist painters sort of weave in and out of there. And he was one that really stuck out as... particularly leaving kind of a distasteful...
Right. Well, and he talks about the death of painting
mm-hmm.
mm-hmm. very specifically.
Mm-hmm.
Like he was painting to work. He was painting paintings for the end of painting.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so I ride my bike to the studio. That's mm-hmm. how I get around mostly. So I was taking my bike in to be serviced.
Mm-hmm.
And in the bike shop, mm-hmm. there was a mural on the wall of mm-hmm. like a bastardized, you know, Broadway boogie woogie.
Really?
And I just saw, and it like, and so that's another, you know, the Van Goghs on the coffee cups and things like that's
yep.
another thing that I just am sort of always looking for is like, how does this historically cultural high point,
right.
how does it get sort of subsumed in culture and then, you know, spat out as a decorative element down
mm-hmm.
the line,
mm-hmm.
you know, and so you ask about the floor.
Mm-hmm.
And so it is literally, you know, that is an example of that, this painting being turned into a decoration that sits on the floor that then these figures sit on top of.
Mm-hmm.
So it becomes a decorative element for the figures to mm-hmm. then rest on top of
mm-hmm.
or triumph over, if you will.
Well, I was just going to say that. I mean, first of all, they don't seem to be aware of it,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Like they're not regarding it. It's
mm-hmm.
not an,
mm-hmm.
it's not important to them, if
mm-hmm.
you will.
Mm-hmm.
Figure on the lower right, which I know you have been very inspired by the photographs of Laura Aguilar,
mm-hmm.
and that figure is inspired by Laura
mm-hmm.
Aguilar.
Yeah, very directly.
Yeah. Yeah. The way that the figure is falling apart, if you will,
mm-hmm.
into the floor.
Mm-hmm.
I've always wondered, like, so many things seem to be happening. Like,
mm-hmm.
the floor, in some ways, seems to be melding with her body.
Mm-hmm.
Is it an act of reparation? Is it an act of aggression? Is it an act of love and sensuality, a kind of sex?
Mm-hmm.
with the painting, mm-hmm. or with the reference of the painting on the floor. Mm-hmm. Can you speak to that a little bit? It's, mm-hmm. I know it's not one thing, mm-hmm. but it's really powerful. And it's also happening in the other figure, mm-hmm. in We Will Remain Separate. So these two figures that have been inspired by Aguilar's work, mm-hmm. they almost feel as though they're being eaten from the inside out, mm. falling apart from mm-hmm. the inside out. Mm-hmm.
Wow, I hadn't thought about it that way. That's really, I mean, that is, brings in, which death is absolutely mm-hmm. always a part of the conversation around painting. I hadn't articulated it to myself in exactly those terms. Mm-hmm. It is all the things you mentioned,
yeah.
absolutely. It is a word that I think of often if when I'm sort of articulating that gesture in my painting is refusal, mm. a refusal to cohere in mm. the way that cohere in terms of another's needs. Mm-hmm. You know, like we have this need, this desire for things to have clear boundaries, mm-hmm. clear outlines, so that then we can consume and move mm-hmm. on. And, you know, there are very clear boundaries in many points in the paintings. And I would say, like, these paintings have more clear boundaries than other bodies of
yeah.
work I've made in the past.
Even in relation to your last body of work.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
yeah. And that has that was something that I puzzled over mm-hmm. throughout the making of this work mm-hmm. is why are these boundaries so clear? It was not something that I mm-hmm. had planned to do at all. Mm-hmm. So there are very, very clear boundaries. And then there are, you know, these choice moments where those boundaries melt or
yeah.
dissolve, where figure ground is being confused, where
yeah.
Subjectivity and psychology is not normative. And within that umbrella of refusal, so many other things, like you mentioned, like the erotic or the feminist
yeah.
or
the maternal
mm-hmm. absolutely yeah all those things can come into that space
mm-hmm. and the figure next to her with this incredible galaxial workout outfit
uh-huh.
I mean she's just remarkable. And speaking of refusal, when I read the painting, those remarkable hands that you render.
Mm.
She appears to be sort of pushing away the iPad
mm, mm-hmm.
in favor of this artist book,
mm, mm-hmm.
of these images of
mm-hmm.
an artist's work.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see that? Is that something that was there for you as you were painting? Her kind of playful refusal?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. And her gaze is something that is so important about that figure. You know, she occupies so much space.
Yeah.
She totally owns the space of that whole left
yeah.
side of the painting.
She really does.
I mean, she really presides over the whole
yeah.
painting.
In fact, so much so that the green chair is like a throne,
mm-hmm.
an aura.
Mm-hmm.
Reminds me of the canopies that were often painted behind
oh,
religious
and the
figures.
Madonnas and things.
Yeah.
Oh,
mm-hmm.
interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure. I hadn't thought of that at all. And yet her gaze, it doesn't even begin to meet ours.
Oh, no.
You know?
Yeah.
So she...
And hers is dissected. I mean,
mm-hmm.
it's just falling apart.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We don't meet anyone's gaze in this painting.
No. Mm-mm. No, not even the cats.
Not even the kitty cat.
Yeah. Another thing I forgot to mention about the figure in the lower right that
mm-hmm.
you're talking about is it's also, that was really the first place that I entered the painting in the act of painting in a less structured way, because like the, you know, the floor
uh-huh.
and the tiles and the rug,
yep.
well, no, I take that back. The tiles all happened first.
Mm-hmm.
And then that figure, and specifically like her sort of, her melting
mm-hmm.
chest and belly
mm-hmm.
were really where I entered the painting. So it's a device for me to sort of move into the work of painting,
mm-hmm.
it, like sort of unhinge that,
mm-hmm.
the gesture of the brushstroke
mm-hmm.
so that then I have more agency to, you know, make it loose or tight throughout the rest of the painting. So it's also a very
mm-hmm.
sort of...
That's really interesting. So this kind of destruction, if you will, of representation
mm-hmm.
as we're used to it becomes a way for you to feel agency in the rest of the painting.
Yes, yes. I mean, I don't know if it gets talked about enough in painting, but there's always, at least my experience is that there's always this sort of like calcification of the movement,
mm-hmm. right.
with a desire to like expand.
Expand seeing?
Expand the possibilities to paint exactly what you want to paint without worrying about fucking it up,
yeah.
you know? And there's always that tension, like, especially, you know, these are the largest paintings I've worked on.
Yeah, these
on.
Are huge compared to anything you've ever made.
Yeah, so, yeah. you know, I don't want to screw up all the work that I've done, but also mm-hmm. if you make a painting from the position of being afraid of screwing
right.
it up, then it has that
right.
contracted.
You feel that tension?
Yeah, so.
But I want to get back to what you just said because I'm not sure I understood it.
Okay.
Entering the painting through a kind of affect, right, of mm-hmm. fearlessness or mm-hmm. an affect of bravery is really important. And it can happen when something seems pretty representational, like the chimera
mm-hmm.
feels like that to me, mm-hmm. even though you're representing this object.
Mm-hmm.
And we see it very clearly in her figure.
Mm-hmm.
But describe for me again, like how you were talking about different forms of representation,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm assuming that every form we see in every painting is as important, or is there a kind of struggle that you're setting up for yourself?
I think I think I struggle with, in the wake of modernism, in my own, you know, psyche. Like objectively, I would say every part is as important, mm-hmm. but some parts feel harder and...
harder in what way?
Harder to like take the plunge and also...
To not fuck them up, like making this galaxial suit? Are we talking about representation?
No, I think harder to sort of... harder in terms of an act of bravery. In my own mind, I privilege because, you know, of my... my training, I privilege maybe a sort of looseness over other forms of representation. And I'm aware of that and I question it and I try to mm. balance it, you know, in my work. But there is a sort of, you know, when I'm painting very quickly, when I'm working with oils, when the oils are really loose, you know, there's this sense of like being on the top of the roller coaster and about
right.
to like that.
Right.
Because there is a, things can not go right, you know.
And so what I think you're talking about is the integrity of the gestures that you're making
mm-hmm.
at that moment.
Yes, yeah.
It's your relationship with the paint.
Yeah.
It has nothing to do with the image.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're about a decade apart in age, mm-hmm. but we've talked before about how, as a woman in art school, it's really difficult because you're taught that you have no role,
mm-hmm.
right,
mm-hmm.
in modernism.
Mm-hmm. Totally. I mean, maybe peripherally. But right. see, the body isn't even, you're not even,
right.
you don't even have a role as the object of, you know,
right.
the viewer's gaze, because
right.
that is gone
right.
in modernism. Yeah.
But I wonder, like, when you talk about some of the fear, like...
Yes.
You wouldn't be concerned about bravery if there wasn't fear on the other side,
right.
if you will.
Right, right.
And I would imagine that fear is the result of that kind of abuse.
I think so.
As a woman artist.
I think so.
Yeah.
And it's also, I mean, you know, you mentioned, like... acts of violence, like withholding, you know,
mm-hmm.
representation of acts of violence.
Mm-hmm.
But there is a sense of impending doom
mm-hmm.
in my paintings,
yep.
you know,
always.
Yeah. And, you know, there are many reasons for that.
Mm-hmm.
And one of them that we have discussed at length is like how, as a girl child growing up,
yep.
you know, in this culture, how I lived under a sense of impending doom,
yeah,
you know,
totally.
Like something's going to happen, lock the doors,
yep.
you know, danger.
Mm-hmm.
So it's deeply psychological. It's deeply personal and, you know, intimate, like
mm-hmm.
my body is vulnerable and it
yep.
is going to be preyed upon.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also very, you know, mental And it's so built into how we indoctrinate people, artists, students, how we interpret art history, how we hold those legacies, that certain you know, subject positions are completely invalid, unacceptable, evil,
absolutely
worthy of disdain. And
I've always felt that your incredible commitment to understanding pre-patriarchal or non-patriarchal cultures is related to understanding the alternatives to that.
Absolutely.
Not just like annihilating it, because violence begets violence, and I feel like that's not what you're interested in, right?
Maybe in a
maybe sometimes,
but not really, because that's not going to be any sort of solution,
right? I want to read something that I quote by you in my essay, and then maybe we'll take a little break. I mean, this statement, the first time I read it, it really blew my mind, because it's not, it's talking about many worlds at once. It's talking about things that are supranatural. It's talking about things that you have to believe in with a kind of almost, I want to say religious, but I don't mean religious in a like organized, but you have to believe in them the way you'd have to believe in the transubstantiation of the wafer into the body of Christ, you know? You say, I paint to resurrect. I paint to lay to rest. I paint to tell the stories that have yet to come to pass. I paint to grieve. I paint to make myths. I paint to talk to the gods. So let's pause and come back to that.
Okay.
Before we took our little break that didn't appear on camera, I quoted your manifesto, if you will, right? Why you paint. And I'm looking at, we're going to talk about the work Chimeras. I'm looking at the work, and we've talked about this before, but at the same time that you are, that you sort of force yourself into a position of a kind of bravery, the bravery that it really takes to put yourself out there as a painter, I think. And I still think painting is the most difficult thing in the world. I mean, painting is, being the kind of painter that you are, being a great painter is so hard. It's just, it's hard.
I'll take that.
Take that. But looking at the painting, and it also happens in the painting, We Will Remain Separate. You have a lot of illusions of solidity. And so there's a lot of doubt, I think, that is also instilled in the work, and in a way instilled in your, in between the lines of your manifesto, right? Is doubt, is a willingness to fail, and a kind of cloaking, if you will, not in a negative sense, but when you say something so incredibly like magical, right? You're on a precipice, and it's really easy to fall from that precipice. And I feel like one of the acts of bravery that I see in your work is that you allow yourself, like you kind of demonstrate that, that fall or that pause or that moment before you jump, or also the obliviousness of some people. Like the character in Chimeras, she's on the floor, she's stretching her body, but what is she really aware of? Like there's this incredibly complex arc above her that's talking to us about information technology, the present, art history, in this remarkable sculpture of a chimera, which the Metropolitan Museum of Art on its label lists as a lizard. It is not a lizard. And it was designed by the great Gothic, neo-Gothic architect Viollet-le-Duc. So it also like bears the presence of really of a desire to understand, or an attempt to understand the past, mm-hmm. to literally like time travel.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And it's next to this old analog clock radio mm-hmm. that seems like it's saying F you. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that was intentional.
It was accidental intentional.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then, you know, behind that or next to it, we see, I mean, there are three mega companies, mm-hmm. like three monopolies mm-hmm. represented in mm-hmm. this painting.
Mm-hmm.
They're integrated in a way that one might say isn't designed to disrupt our sense of the fact that it's a painting with
right.
objects.
Mm-hmm.
But we have Apple on the right.
Mm-hmm.
We have Starbucks mm-hmm. near the top.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have Amazon on
mm-hmm.
the left.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, the Amazon box is such an incredible symbol of what, like, how objects and ideas are delivered to us and how we see them now.
Yes.
And I love that you have placed it in the painting. It's being occupied by a cat that really doesn't give a shit whether it's an Amazon box or something
right,
else.
Right, right.
One of the things that's so remarkable about this painting is that it also demonstrates what just your incredible skill and facility. I mean, that rendering of the decorative ceramic sculpture blows my mind.
Mm.
And you could, if you chose, paint the entire painting that way.
Mm-hmm.
And you choose very intentionally not to.
Mm-hmm.
And this figure, the way that she's rendered with this like really disturbing flatness.
Mm-hmm.
You see the nipple of her right breast,
mm-hmm.
but it's like almost to her crotch.
Right.
I mean, her body has just been sort of mangled and collapsed,
mm-hmm.
and we have no sense of what she's thinking.
Mm-hmm.
She has this very, very blank expression going on.
Mm-hmm.
We wanted to talk about the presence of industry and aesthetics and images and information. Commodity culture versus aesthetic culture.
Yeah.
And I think in this painting, we have everything we need to really have a real conversation about that. So tell us about it. How do you decide, like, when those objects invade the space? And do you see them as invaders? Like, how do you see that?
That is interesting. But I don't think I see them as invaders. I see them as tools.
Mm-hmm.
Because
what kind of tools?
Well, the painting has a, like, so in, you know, in our consensual reality that we occupy right now, I would say I do see them as invaders. Yeah. They're these corporate entities that are destroying, you know, the planet and our lives and
yeah.
sort of like our souls and our ability to have autonomy and things like that. But the space of the painting is not the space of consensual reality. The space of the painting is such a subtly different space than that, but that like subtle difference, it means the world. I really deliberately work with simulation. I've
yeah.
been thinking of the word simulacra
yeah.
a lot recently, as a way to sort of like lull us into a relationship as if it were consensual
right.
reality,
right.
but it's not. It's
right.
a space that's governed by wholly different laws than that. The
yep.
laws of
that we don't even really know. Nor
no,
do we
but
take
I think,
the time to
but
read.
But I do think we there's an innate recognition
mm-hmm.
of that, because it's more the space of desire,
mm-hmm.
memory,
mm-hmm.
Which then, you know, amplified on a cultural level is the space of mythology
mm-hmm.
and that which underlies religion
right.
and that which underlies, you know, politics, really
right.
sort of
and
everything.
Really,
so these, you know, my paintings do not take place in the world of, you know, point and click. They take place in the space, in a space that then things like Amazon or Apple become tools by which I can lure the viewer into sort of a kind of complacency.
Mm-hmm.
But then,
because they're so familiar.
They're so familiar, but then there are other things happening. There's another stream of experience that is actually, you know, taking place mm-hmm. or guiding the relationship to the painting. And so,
like the figure of the chimera.
Yeah, the chimera, or the relationship between the chimera and the human figure.
Yeah.
You know, that was sort of the base. Like I saw this image of the chimera, which I have not actually seen at the Metropolitan. Next time I go, I'm going to find it.
Oh, yeah.
If it's on display. Right. But I had that image in my studio for a long time. And I wasn't even thinking of chimera, of the story mm-hmm. of the chimera, which since, you know, having read the myth and, you know, Bellerophon kills the chimera. Mm-hmm. And then your research that you shared with me about sort of the resurgence of the chimera in the Victorian era.
19th century French symbolist painting. And also neo-Gothic painting,
right.
Neo-Gothic sculpture.
Right.
And, yeah.
Yeah. And its representation of like evil femininity and stuff.
Yeah.
None of that was in my mind. Mm-hmm. And this is part of what I love about painting is, you know, these convergences of things that then meaning is discovered or co-created
Absolutely.
Later. But that there, I knew I wanted there to be a relationship between that figure of the chimera and this figure of the woman who's doing yoga on a yoga mat, which is actually my yoga mat.
My yoga mat is so meticulously rendered.
My 20-year-old ratty yoga mat. Something about her, you know, her pose being so open.
Yeah.
And, you know, her pelvis is open.
Yeah, and we see the triangle of her crotch like we do in the other painting.
But that was sort of the origin mm-hmm. story of the part of the origin story of this painting was like the kind of inverse relationship between.
Yeah, they really do have that complementary relationship.
Mm-hmm.
I'd love for you to talk a little bit with us about the weightiness and the figures, like kind of going back to where we began, this kind of drag and drift, I call it in my essay, of how the figures seem weighted and pulled and deeply interiorized in a way that they were not in your last body of work.
Yeah.
So maybe we'll end with a little discussion about that.
Okay. It's interesting as you're saying that, I'm just hearing that in a way that I haven't thought about it before, which is there's almost a quality of like, it could be interpreted as like a drugged mm-hmm, quality, mm-hmm. Sedated.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I mean, this, you alluded to this at first, which was this work was begun.
Yeah, whatever.
This work was begun.
It began.
In January of 2020.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So just as sort of the murmurings of something happening
right.
were starting to filter in.
Right.
But it's a hard time to start work. So there was a heaviness with this work from the offset. Mm-hmm. And then as the, you know, and this body of work was very resistant to actualization. It took a lot of kind of
will,
which I didn't feel like I had like necessarily the nourishment to mm-hmm. to provide that, but I was doing it anyway. Right. So there's a quality of scraping the bottom of the barrel.
Mm-hmm. You're amazing. We're both people who can force themselves to work, and it's a skill, I guess, one develops over time. But it is a survival skill, really.
It is.
Yeah.
It also, I mean, my work was, even though it was so hard to go to the studio, I kept going to the studio because my studio is very, totally, completely solitary and very safe to go to. But if I hadn't had that, I would have totally lost it mm-hmm. because what would I be doing at home, biting the tips of my fingers
right.
off.
You can't do this at home.
No, I can't. Well, it also, I mean, it's a productive distraction.
Yeah.
And more than that, I mean, it's the purpose of my, you know, existence. But so this work really, it was hard. It got way under heavy conditions. And then, and the work was itself was resistant to sort of actualization, and then it was made under increasingly heavy conditions. So, you know, we've talked about the clarity of boundaries that is, and the sort of coherence, the greater coherence of the bodies in this work, say, as opposed to my past work. And those are all things that I was not expecting to be part of the work. They were sources of confusion, doubt, befuddlement throughout the making of the work. And also I felt like they were things that were manifesting, and part of what I do is just follow, you know, the threads that are manifesting. And but yeah, I think looking back on it now, I mean, interiority, the sort of bleeding out of the spaces are much emptier. Mm-hmm. There's no horizon lines, you know, it's very like there's a sense of confinement.
Yep.
And that interiority that you mentioned in the figures is also sometimes, you know, somnambulistic. It is partially a reflection of the conditions under which the work was made, and it's partially a vista that I'm still investigating.
Right.
I mean, each body of work is sort of a question that leads me into more questions.
That's so beautiful, beautifully said. I guess we should probably stop, even though we don't want to. But we get to continue this conversation on our own right now.
Yeah.
And for many years to come.
Thank you for the amazing questions.
It's Oh my gosh. Well, it's just a gift. It's
and
a
your
gift
reflections.
To know you, to work with you. Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.